The beer du jour is Pioneer Harvest Stout from Farmery Estate Brewing in Neepawa, Manitoba. Estate brewery. Kind of like an estate winery. Basically, all the ingredients come from their property, from their farm. Very cool idea. I will be pairing tonight's beer with this kit that I got from my buddy Gadget Reboot in Ontario. I was actually thinking of trying to get a beer from his area, but I've already been to the beer store too many times this week, so I'll have to go local. Not a major hardship. So here's the kit and all the stuff that was in the package. And one thing that I didn't realize, or I didn't look at because I didn't dig deep enough into the thing, was he had also sent me a schematic for the kit. Ooh, that's bright. Hang on. There. I've discovered Big Clive's trick of changing the exposure whenever I do things like this. So, what this kit is, he calls it a 555 timer dev board. So, it's your basic 555, the chip that we all know and love. And it's got a bunch of jumper plugs surrounding it so that you can add and subtract components. Basically, it's sort of one step more permanent-ish than throwing the 555 on a breadboard and stuffing components in, kind of like that, or that end of this circuit anyways. But, like I said, it's a little bit more permanent, it's slightly less janky. So let's get busy. What else? Oh, hey, he sent me a sticker. That's cool. Let's park that over there for now. And if I remember correctly, yeah, this has the components on it. So he's got three different resistors involved. And he's installed some of these surface mount components, which is kind of cool. And so it's just a handful of through-hole components for me to solder on. And then some pins, and the 555s I do have to put on. Those are surface mounts, and he's left those for the builder of the kit. But there's the board, and here's a lot of little jumper plugs that go in, and header pins and stuff. That's a little jumper, you can turn it on and off, because that comes from the VCC. I've got some through-hole capacitors to solder on, a couple of diodes. Okay, that should be a fairly simple little soldering project. And just to challenge myself a little bit, I will be using the new T12 iron. The only reason it's a challenge is because it came with this big chisel tip, which is not ideal for soldering small components, but I'm gonna give it a shot. What the hell? I do have some smaller tips ordered. They, of course, are somewhere between here and China. When they come in, I'll show you. So I'm going to do the soldering on this little silicone mat. It's sort of heat resistant. It's not going to catch fire. And hopefully it'll protect my cutting mat a little bit. I don't know. What does the blue look like on camera? Interesting? Sure. And I think I'll probably put some of these through-hole components on first. But I'm going to leave the sheet of paper off to the side mostly, just so that it doesn't cause the exposure on the camera to go all wonky. Mostly. I'll pull it in now and again. I think I'll start with these two diodes here. And those two diodes go there and there. Now these are the diodes that are typically in a 555 circuit when you're using it in, which mode is that? In PWM mode. They provide a little bit of an offset. And I've already done an ugly little job of putting that one in. Yeah, well. Actually, yeah, where's the schematic? I'm going to blow it out here. So that's these two diodes here. And that would be the PWM pot when it's involved. And that goes up to the duty cycle percentage pin there. Let's see how soldering with this big iron works. Not bad if you get it in that way, I guess. A little awkward. I'm I like the iron. It's got its nice lightweight handle. And, but when I get some smaller tips in, I think it's going to be much more fun. Although this is a good challenge. Okay, that's that. Next, let's put in a couple of capacitors. At least 2 1-microfarad electrolytics. I just noticed he didn't put the values on the board. Okay. C2 and C4, it says on that sheet. C2 is that one. Doesn't quite match the footprint, but oh well. And C4, which is this one over here. Now C2, if I remember, is part of the timing circuit. Yeah, it's that guy. And C4 is part of the power supply smoothing. Why is that not melting that? I'm not getting good contact. There we go. Yeah, it's not impossible to solder with the wrong size tip. It's just really challenging. But that's okay. This isn't really a proper test for this iron anyway. I'll do a full video on it once I get the other tips and take a look at it closer. There's those 2 electrolytic capacitors. Now then, I got 2 ceramic capacitors, C1 and C3. C3 is part of timing and C1 is the other smoothing capacitor. Okay. Okay, C1 just goes down there. I wonder if that's going to make it hard for me to solder that 555. Yeah, maybe I'll leave him for later. Here's C3 then, which is 100 nano according to the sheet. And it's drawn on here as an electrolytic footprint, but it isn't according to the parts list. As much as I don't want to give up, I'm not having fun with this big tip right now. So I'm just going to set it aside right now and I'm going to go back to my Beku with a finer tip on it. And honestly, it's not even that much smaller a tip. It's just able to get down in there a little bit easier. Amazing how much difference a tip makes. Also, for some reason, I'm using my old cutters. The ones that I beat up. I bought a new pair for a reason. So next in, we have the 3 pots. R1 and R3 are these 1 megs. And he says here, use the middle 3 pins of the 5-pin footprint. Okay, I will. R1 and R3. There's R3. Over there. There's R1 down there. So there are 1 pin down first. Did I get it straight and square? Close. Let me just... There we go. That looks better. Let me get the other 2. And this one... Which one did I say that was? R3. Okay. Which way should that go? Does that look good? Yeah, that'll do. But again, I'll just tack one in place. Then I can get that out of the way. Put that down nice and square. And then jam the other 2 down here. Oh, come on. You need to have the iron in contact with both the pad and the wire or the lead for it to work properly. That's nice. And the third pot is R2 500K, which goes down there. That 555 is going to be a pain in the ass. I should just do it rather than wondering what's in its way and what's not. So he sent me a pair of 555s. Not sure if that was just in case I lose one because they're so freaking tiny, or because he has seen me soldering and knows that there's a fair risk that I'll destroy one. I don't know. So the dots in that corner, and actually I think I will tin one pad because that's the easiest way to get them to stay put. Yeah, it means that guy goes that way. Yeah, not quite. Okay, at least the pads are all lined up now. Now I'll just toss some solder onto the other ones and hope I don't bridge them. I should have done this before I put those pots on. They look like they've all got solder on them, I think. I don't know. I'm still learning on this surface mount stuff. Okay, so now I guess I should put this capacitor in that I didn't put in before. That's so much easier. I like through-hole. Okay, now I'll just drop in all these jumper pins for the various different things and solder them in place. Get in. Those are not really holding with the tack, but I'll deal with that properly in a moment here. Ow. Not so ow. Important to hold it on the pin that you're not soldering. And you're pushing them in place. And then just solder down the other pin. And retouch up the first one. Just because it got a little bit crusty being pressured like that. Okay, so there's all those pins. There's only a couple more sets of pins to go in. There's this little array of four pins there. And this array of eight pins there, which is all the pins. Oh, and there's a little array of three pins there. I seem to have lost those ones. Oh, well, I have pins in my collection. Lots and lots of them, including handy little three-pin jubby right on the top there. Finish that up, and that should be the last of the soldering. Unless I missed something. Touch that one up a little bit, maybe. All that's left now is to snap these little feet in here. Just so that it can stand up off my workbench. And not get shorted out on any of the carnage and debris. If I power this up now, one of those two LEDs should come on because the 555 will either be putting out a high or a low because it won't be oscillating because neither of the capacitors are connected. The reset's not connected. The trigger's not connected to the threshold. Over here he says between 5 and 9 volts, which is reasonable for a 555 timer. Okay, I have between 5 and 9 volts on my test, on my little test power supply here, 5.89 specifically. So I'll connect this up to ground and VCC. And turn that on. And nothing happens because the power jumper's not in. So with the power jumper on, it's sort of got an indeterminate output because there's nothing on the any of the capacitors, and the resistors are all just set to whatever they're set to. All right, so I've got it set up per this A-stable mode oscillator. I have both capacitors in parallel. I have J2 installed, which is the trigger pin. I have J5 installed between pins 2 and 3 of that header there, this one here. And I have J7 installed between pin 1 and 2 of its this here, which connects pin R1 to the discharge pin and R2 to the discharge pin. So R1 goes to VCC and R2 goes between the threshold and the discharge. The threshold is where the capacitors are, right? So basically one of those is the charge and one of them is the discharge resistor. And yeah, those two capacitors are both in the circuit. That's there. We've got the power jumper in. So let's connect some power, which today is 5.89 volts DC. Connect that to the VCC and the ground. And power on. And we have oscillating. Not a perfect square wave, not a perfect duty cycle. That's what these two guys are for. So if we pull C2 out, oh, we're going blazingly fast. Actually, the shutter speed's not doing that justice. That's going really, really fast. Plug that guy back on, and it slows it right down. That doesn't make much difference with just that one in, but I can change what's going on with the potentiometers. Very short duty cycle. Okay, I declare that working. If you want to see all the modes demonstrated much more than I am going to, go over to Gadget Reboot's YouTube channel. I'll put a link up in the corner and down in the description. I will also put a link in the description to his GitHub, where it has a copy of the schematic and some information. And he's got a parts placement drawing and the schematic and the jumper configs. Yeah. Well, that was a fun little kit build. Nice basic little circuit. A few challenges soldering in the surface mount because it's surface mount and it's challenging. But all in all, a pretty cool little circuit. And I think that's going to be handy to have around, just to have another little random timer that I can connect stuff up to that isn't sitting all janky on a breadboard. Thanks to Gadget Reboot for sending this over. That was a lot of fun. Thanks to everybody else for watching. Comments and questions down in the comments section. Link to Gadget Reboot's stuff that I mentioned earlier in the description. I will talk to you later.